Good afternoon, welcome to EduSat Network. Friend, as you know, today is the 9th August and this date is a very important date in the history of India, in history of modern India. You all are aware that 70 years ago, on 9th August 1942, a movement was launched, Quit India Movement, and first time Gandhiji gave the slogan, Do or Die. So this holds a very important date for all of us, so no other topic would have been better to discuss than Quit India Movement. So we have chosen this topic and I will try to understand the genesis of Quit India Movement, its course of movement and also significance and legacy of this movement. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in the studio the same resource person, Dr. Jain Sinha, eminent historian, and presently he teaches history in Rajdhani College. So on your behalf, I welcome Dr. Sinha for EduSat lecture on this very topic. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. Friends, as has been announced, we are going to talk about the great event of 1942, that is Quit India Movement. A student of Indian history is very much aware of the event, but we will try to go deeper into that and we will try to find out its genesis, the course of the events, then why it subsided or in some way it failed, at least immediately, and despite all that, what is the significance and legacy of this movement for India today. So far as the genesis is concerned, India's freedom struggle had started almost in 1857 with the revolt at that time. After that, we have talked about the Swadeshi movement and several other revolts and rebellions they were going on. From Swadeshi movement, there was a constant thinking in terms of gaining Swaraj, means freedom, self-rule, and after coming of Mahatma Gandhi, it was very much clear that the whole national effort was oriented towards gaining the freedom of the country. So this was the tempo of the time. After that, we know about a lot of events. For example, Gandhi's rural reconstruction program, which was aimed ultimately towards gaining freedom of the country by making ourselves self-sufficient and strong against the British imperialism. Then the Simon Commission, after that the provincial introduction of provincial autonomy, and finally introduction of ministries, elected ministries in the provinces. But all these developments, they were efforts towards gaining independence, but they were not all successful as our nationalist leader wanted them to be. Of course, in 1935, provincial autonomy was introduced, but we have seen its result, that how the British government created obstacle in the working of the ministries, and finally they had to resign in 1939 with the outbreak of the Second World War. It was this high point that the Indian leadership thought in terms of doing something much more substantial, maybe stronger in every sense of the term. And this was the time that Mahatma Gandhi decided initially he had decided a totally non-violent movement as ever, and he stuck to his philosophy also, and he made a call for the Quit India Movement, and he there it was at the venue of the Congress session that he delivered his very historic lecture, Do or Die. So this was just a genesis, but in this genesis we may go is a little deeper, that I have talked about the failure of the nationalist measures, and we have indirectly also referred to the British obstinacy not to yield to the nationalist demands. But this was time also of the Second World War. Some events of the war time provoked Indians to go something in a much more violent manner. And one of them was racial discrimination in connection with the withdrawal of soldiers from war fronts, especially from Malay and Burma. We know that this was the area which was very fragile for the British, because there was aggression from the Japanese and they were almost knocking at the door of India to capture at least the eastern part of the country. And so the British at some stage had to withdraw their soldiers from there. But in doing so, they showed some type of partiality based on the race. And whenever it was planned, they moved the white soldiers from the war front first. And in fact, they left the others, the Indian soldiers, there on their fate. So this was a very cruel discrimination which Indians noted. Apart from that, as the war progressed, there was a huge crisis, and Japan being very close to India, Britain was in real crisis at the time, as it was in crisis in relation to Germany, because Germany was very much aggressive towards Britain. And all these things eroded the stability of the British Empire and their strength. So in India also, it was realized that the British Empire, now it is ebbing out, and everyone thought that it was not going to be existing anymore. And so this had implications for financial transaction and business also. People started withdrawing money from post offices and banks, etc. As a whole, all these developments gave a picture that war crisis has compelled Britain, rather it has crippled Britain, and the stability of the British Empire in the East, including in India, is very much in danger. So this was the time that Indian nationalists also, they thought that this is the time one should raise a new form of aggression, even if non-violent, against the British. And this is the genesis how the Quit India movement started. In fact, about this movement, Congress leadership was thinking for quite some time, but Mahatma Gandhi discussed the matter at the Wardha with the Congress Working Committee in July 1942. In this deliberation, he indicated that what is going to be done in future, and several developments took place, and at Wardha and other places also, he indicated that they are going to raise the tempo of the freedom struggle. And for that, Gandhi urged upon the people of the country, of different sections of the people of the country, to be ready to sacrifice themselves for the sake of the country. In fact, he detailed in his lectures, private talks, and in his draft proposal also, and he expected from every section of society to do something. For example, from students and youth, from farmers, from government official, and he proposed a very reasonable method of defiance against the British government. For example, he proposed that those peasants who have courage and those who can afford it, they should go for non-payment of taxes, something like that. He also proposed that those officials who could afford and those who could have courage, they could defy the British Indian government. So these type of things started talked about there. And what was earlier private talk, now it was proposed to be a formal resolution by the Congress Working Committee at its session at Bombay. This is on 7th of August, he had made a proposal of this nature, and finally it was decided that this will be the method of final protest against the British, about which Mahatma Gandhi indicated that this is going to be very crucial but very swift. Means it's not going to last long, and it implied that it is going to be very much widespread and very strong and dedicated. So this was the thinking of the national leaders, and the British intelligence was there. They were guessing everything, what is going to happen. And it was in this situation that the British government, British Indian government, wanted to preempt the whole planning of Mahatma Gandhi and the Congress. And so when they came to know that at Gwalior Tank in Bombay, the party's working committee and all the leaders are going to meet there, there is going to be a wide public meeting at night. And they arrested all the top leaders of the country, and those leaders were sent to unknown destination. So on 9th, today, 70 years back in Bombay, there was a very sharp reaction against the official repression of arrest of top national leaders. The people gathered there in thousands and thousands. And they didn't only gather, rather they clashed there with the authorities. And this was the beginning of the Quit India movement. Of course, the government was already there thinking about cut the movement in the beginning, and so it made the arrest. It had already equipped itself with sufficient legislation in terms of war, crisis of the war, and with the help of that elaborate revolutionary movement ordinance, now they were in a position to arrest almost everybody. So all this situation arose at the time, and now this was the beginning of the Quit India movement in Bombay, but it soon spread to all other areas. For example, it spread to Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, it spread to Maharashtra. In Bombay it had begun, but it soon spread. On 9th August there were some disturbances and clashes in Ahmedabad and Pune also. Ahmedabad in Gujarat and Pune in Maharashtra. Likewise, on 10th the movement broke out in Delhi, in UP at Kanpur, Allahabad, Varanasi, and in Bihar at several places, almost in the whole of North Bihar and Central Bihar. There were hartals, there were demonstrations, there were protest march, and of course there was arrest of people was there. Likewise, the government gagged the press, and National Herald and Harijan, they stopped their publication for the whole of the duration of the Quit India movement. In such a situation, when all the top leaders were arrested, the local leaders in all the provinces, they had already been given instruction that in case the top leadership goes to jail, they will handle the situation with their own wisdom and imagination and creativity. And likewise, they did in provinces also. They gave a shape to their movement in those provinces and in everywhere. Whatever was the symbol of the British authority, any institution, any person, they were attacked. For example, the main centers of attack were railway station, police station, post offices, judicial courts, and anything which showed that the British power was stationed there. And at all these places, national flag was unfurled. Gradually, it spread to villages also. In fact, in UP and Bihar, it spread to remote villages, and there people started coming to the railway tracks, and they destroyed their railway tracks. In the meanwhile, several forms of agitation were innovated, and the activists started publishing patrikas and handouts, and they started distributing them in different places, especially in the industrial towns. Workers launched strikes. So this was a very critical situation all over the country, especially, as I have said, in Bihar. It was much more disturbing for the British Empire. For example, in Uttar Pradesh at Varanasi, now the universities got involved. BHU students, they entered into far-flung villages and they spread the message of Quit India movement and do and die. And the result was that in Balia, a parallel government was announced. And these type of parallel governments were announced at different places in Maharashtra, in Bengal, in Uttar Pradesh. It was announced at Balia under Chittu Pandey, one Chittu Pandey. He was Gandhian, but the situation forced him to defy whole hog all the British authority. He unfurled the flag there and he declared that the whole population of that area was living under a free Indian government. Of course, it was short-lived. Nevertheless, it was very important that they had defied the government. Likewise, in Bengal at Tamluk, similar government was formed. At Satara in Maharashtra, a similar parallel government was formed there. Everywhere now, all segment of the Indian society, including peasants, workers, students, women, even government officials, took part of in these type of movements. Naturally, the government retaliated very soon, and the extent of retaliation was not only the arrest of the masses who had revolted against the British. Rather, they were shot very mercilessly. Even the low-flying aircrafts were used to machine gun the villages, and several of the villages were uprooted. People were taken hostage, they were arrested without any sufficient legal provisions, and they were sent to unknown destination. This type of brutality in various parts of the country, especially in Uttar Pradesh, in Delhi, in Bihar, in Maharashtra, this led to some other form of agitation, and that was the development of underground networks. It means those people, those youth, those leaders who were not able to resist the British government openly, thanks to different legal provisions and brutality of the British government, they resorted to secret activities and they formed underground networks. Some of the more important leaders of that group were Achyut Patwardhan, Aruna Asaf Ali, Ram Manohar Lohia, Sucheta Kriplani, Chotu Bhai Puranik, Biju Patnaik, R.P. Goenka and Jai Prakash Narayan. These were the people who went underground and they formed networks which engineered some disruptive activities against the British Empire. Why this type of disruptive activities? Because they were not able to act openly, so they thought it proper that secretly at least they should try to erode the authority and sternness of the British government by creating disruption, whether it was disruption in the railways, running of train and railway lines, they destroyed railway lines, or the police station, and in several way they disrupted the government and the social life with a view to disrupt the local British Indian civil government there. All these developments, they were supported, interestingly, they were supported not only by active politicians, but also by women living in houses, housewives, by youth, by common students there. Even the government official, they help them by conniving in some way. For example, they passed on some important information to revolutionaries. Likewise, they also in some cases they provided shelter to the activists. This type of development took place there, and this horrified the government, and the more they did, the more the government became aggressive and brutal. This was the situation that the British Indian government started forcing Mahatma Gandhi and Morley to condemn this type of violence. But the Mahatma, he didn't yield, and he said that he refused to condemn this type of violence because he held the British government responsible for provoking this type of violence. So he thought that if it has been provoked by the British at such a large scale and with such a brutality, it was no fault of Indians if they responded to that accordingly. So this was a peculiar situation that the British government was now trying to persuade Mahatma Gandhi to condemn this type of revolt, but he didn't do that. And this was a peculiar situation when Mahatma Gandhi, guessing that the British may take some harsher measure both against him and his followers, and in that way they would disrupt the whole of the movement. So he took to another measure, and he took to another fast on 10th February in 1942 for 21 days in jail. He was already in jail, and there he showed his annoyance by going for fast for 21 days. This fast did have very much desired result. In fact, Mahatma Gandhi was already careful about avoiding the trap the British were had laid for him, because they wanted that the Mahatma should be much more vocal. He should be found somewhere instigating the public. So he always avoided. Even his philosophy didn't allow this type of thing. But the British wanted to compel him to bring to such a situation, and not only him, rather all other followers of Mahatma Gandhi or his principle, they wanted to compel them to yield to such a situation. But fortunately, the Mahatma remained very much careful about that, and very cleverly he started a different technique of fast again. This fast became very much a potent tool against the British. And what Mahatma has desired, he had desired that this fast will bring the Indian issue in the limelight, and in a national and international response will favor the Indian cause, and people all over the world will come to know how the British government was being harsh to people who were non-violent in their country. So this was the situation. That is, desired result came very soon, rather immediately, not only from the Indian population, but also from outside. Many of the important newspapers of Britain, including Manchester Guardian, New Statesman, Nation, and Chicago Sun, British, these were newspapers which demanded Mahatma's release from the jail, and so that he could forbid his fast effort. Likewise, the British Communist Party made similar demand. Prominent citizens of London also demanded, London and Manchester, and Women's International League, Australian Council of Trade Unions, Ceylon State Council, and the US government started raising pressure on the British Indian government to release the Mahatma. And behind this release and this type of persuasion, the implied contention was also the freedom of the country. Take for example, this was the time when the American government put pressure on the British Indian government for the development of India and also its freedom. It's very much known the controversy and the annoyance of Churchill, which was read after the discussion and a discussion between Churchill and Roosevelt. In that meeting, Roosevelt had requested for the liberation of the country and for India's development, which Churchill always disliked, he despised, and he was always against the freedom of the country. So, despite all these situations, there was a public concern from all over the world which favored India, even if the British government didn't like it. But some of the worst things came very soon for the British government, and one of that was resignation by some of the three Indian members of the Viceroy's Executive Council. They were MSNA, NR Sarkar, and HP Modi. They were part of the top administration. They were members of the Viceroy Executive Council. But in protest of the attitude of the government towards the Indian people, especially towards the fast of Mahatma Gandhi and his non-violent peaceful activities, they resigned from the government. This was a alarming a note for the British Indian government, though even now the British Indian government retaliated, and Churchill was in no mood to consider India's case sympathetically. Not only that, in fact, they were thinking that let the Mahatma die in the fast, and secretly they were trying making preparation for his funeral also. So this was the extreme height the British could retaliate for their stay in India. But Gandhi's movement was, even though it was symbolic in several cases, it had a great power, greater power than any tool of violence, and it was gathering support from all over the world. So this was the situation. The revolt, the Quit India movement started in August, on 9th August, and in the next 7 or 8 weeks, there was great crisis and turmoil almost all over the country, in all the most of the provinces of the country. There was retaliation from both sides. The Indians indulged in different disruptive activities all over the countries. Those disruptive activities also led to lives also. But in the same manner, the British retaliated with greater strength, so much so that they arrested the whole villages. They fired recklessly even from the aeroplane on the whole village or crowd, something like that. This was something like a war situation where the aircraft and something like that is used to quell a movement. So this was the situation in which the British, of course, they became successful in suppressing the Quit India movement, and Mahatma Gandhi had to go again for fast, living in jail, and thus the movement in a way came to an end after say about a month and a little more than that. But the sound and fury of this movement continued longer also. In several areas, people worked in the spirit of the Quit India movement. They had heard from the Mahatma, great Mahatma, there his lecture of famous lecture of do and die, and somehow, despite his counseling for non-violence, people were ready to die now. And if they were ready to die for national cause, this dimension was going to expand to such an extent where they were able to cause death for others also. So, in course of this great rebellion, at several places, staunch Gandhians resorted to some type of violence. When they were asked about that, they didn't deny. And they, what they replied, it was that we were forced to a situation where there was no other way than to resort to such activities to save their lives. So this was the situation. And this short-lived Quit India movement, from which Mahatma appealed for non-violence and peaceful methods, ultimately came to an end. But it sounds remained there, resounding in Indian politics, and many great things, even if some there was not direct results, but it led to long-term legacies for India, both under bondage and in freedom, after freedom. So after 70 years, this movement, we can now have a retrospective reflection on this movement. First, we will try to see, even if this was a short movement, what were the main significant features? And one of the significant features is that during this revolt, Indians created in several provinces parallel government. This was maybe for the first time that at such a scale, Indians created parallel government, which means they declared that we are free, we are not under the British, and they tried to run a civil administration also. They did some type of justice, they helped people in different ways. So parallel governments, I have already talked about parallel government in Balia, in Bengal, in Maharashtra, and they continued for some time, and they also resorted to some type of constructive work, which was again taken up by Mahatma Gandhi when he was released after much pressure from the public from the jail. So this was the development of formation of parallel government was one of the main significant development of this rebellion. Likewise, this movement should be remembered for the huge popular participation. There were earlier movements were there in the past also, and participation was there, but it was maybe we may remember the revolt at 1857 and then Swadeshi movement, and after that this Quit India movement. But even in the earlier two events, revolt and Swadeshi movement, the total segment of population was limited compared to the participation in the Quit India movement, because in this movement students and youth were in the forefront. From irrespective of anything, they were in the forefront leading the Quit India movement. Likewise, women, even the housewives, the educated women, illiterate women in villages and elsewhere, and small kasbas and the towns, they participated in the protest march and in different forms of agitation. One of the leading leaders of women at that time was Aruna Asaf Ali and Sucheta Kriplani. Likewise, workers also participated. This participation in earlier movements I have mentioned, or any other movement in the past, it was very limited. But this time they staged strikes at different places, and also they braved police repression. After the workers, students, women and workers, peasants were another segment who participated in this movement in a very, very wide manner in most of the centers of the Quit India activities. And in the smaller places, these peasants, small peasants, they took part, and they, from villages, they crowded the smaller cities, kasbas, local bazaars. They went there and they took part in the opposition activities against the British rule there. But in rural areas and smaller places, where the life in general was rural, some of the big jamindars also took part in this Quit India movement, And one of the best examples is the Raja of Darbhanga. He was one of the biggest Jamindar of this country, but he participated in this movement, though slightly indirectly, because there were a lot of technical problems with whom which forced him not to participate actively. But for example, he denied the British government to use his own militia against the Indians during the Quit India movement. Likewise, he gave instruction to his officials to help the peasants who were being harassed by the British Indian police. So this type of participation of the rich Jamindars was also visible in the Quit India movement. Likewise, another segment, maybe for the first time at such a scale, that even the government officials were participating in the activities of the Quit India movement. They were not doing it very much directly, but their contribution was significant and crucial. For example, they gave shelter to activists, to underground network. They acted as messenger and couriers to convey messages, as were used small children at that time to send messages from one place to another. Small children were used for that. So this type of activities were done also by government officials. But the most important of that the government officials always gave information about the designs of the British against the local population. For example, whenever the British government was planning to raid some village or some area or some person, they used to pass on information in advance, so that people became cautious and they will try to evade the British operation and arrest. So this was another segment, and which is very much significant, because this showed that even the machinery on which the British Indian government was built in India, it was not faithful to it. And this way, this eroded the stability and strength of the British colonial government in India. Likewise, even if the Muslim participation was not very large at this time, because communal issue had cropped up by now, and the public opinion was divided in India also on communal lines, Hindu and Muslim and all that. So the participation was not very widespread, because the British were very much careful to use the Muslim against the majority Hindu. And so they were trying their best to just persuade them to remain either aloof or participate in the British authorities' activities. But Muslims in general avoided this type of participation with the government. Rather, information is that some of even the members of the Muslim League, and they gave shelter to revolutionaries at that time. So this was another segment of Indian population which participated in this movement at that time. And lastly, I would talk about the communists, because generally it is held that the communists were not supporting the freedom movement around this time. This is true in some way, though for that there is reason that they were being guided by their international strategy. And since they were following the Russian line, and Russia at that time it was with the British, so they were avoiding any confrontation with the British, and they had been directed by the party to keep slightly silent against the British at that time. But despite that, hundreds of them participated in this movement, at least at the village level, and all this they were doing against the wishes of the party high command. So this movement, this way, was able to enjoy the participation of the maximum segment of Indian population. Now there is a question which is issue of debate, that was this movement a spontaneous outburst or it was organized rebellion? This is a matter of discussion, whether it was, because the way it broke out, it was very much spontaneous. Mahatma Gandhi, he had not said anything to resort to violence or like that, or to be much aggressive. He had not said that, but all of a sudden this happened and people became aggressive and even violent. So this shows its spontaneity, but it doesn't mean that it didn't have any earlier background. Of course, activities were going on for quite some time, and even on the resolution of the All India Congress Committee of 8th August 1942, it has suggested its members and followers to use their wisdom and creativity when the situation arose and emergency came, when the Congress High Command was not in a position to be in touch with the workers and party members. This situation was visualized because the party was very much apprehensive that any time now the British Indian government will arrest the top leaders, which happened in reality also, and in that position it won't be possible to run the party in a proper manner. So in advance they had instructed its party members to use their wisdom and go by the policy of the party in general and articulate that policy of non-violence with aim for Swaraj and complete freedom of the country, to articulate this goal and motto in such way that the final goal is achieved. And this freedom to articulate their wisdom also meant that if they wanted, they can think as they wished. So there was no limit, and it was given by Congress Party also. It had been also hinted by Mahatma Gandhi. He also allowed the party worker to use their own conscience, and naturally the conscience against the British at that time could be nothing but only a call for quit India and do and die. So this was the situation that of course there was a spontaneity, but some type of earlier motivation effort was there. Not only that, some organizational activities were going on at that time. For example, Sardar Patel had been touring Bardoli and other areas, warning people of the impending struggle. He was suggesting them that something may come very soon, there will be a problem, and so what people should do at that time, he was giving them some idea, and one of the idea was that people should stop giving revenue to the government. Likewise, Congress socialists, they were holding training camps for volunteers since June 1942 in Pune. That was a political congregation, and naturally this type of workshop was meant for making a planning for this type of movement at the time. I have already talked about Mahatma Gandhi, how in his disobedience campaign in 1940 and 41, and more directly since 1942, he was preparing people for the coming battle, and he had invoked something to be ready to do or die, and he visualized that there is going to be a short movement, short and swift, and possibly with some great results. So all these things were in mind, and it had been brought to mind of the people who revolted in 1942. So some element of organization was there. The next question, that if Mahatma Gandhi was following a policy of non-violence, how did the Quit India movement squares up with that ideology? Definitely this is a crucial question, And here one has to see in between the lines. Of course, Mahatma Gandhi never advocated any non-violent method. He was always for peaceful protest at that time, at most reaching up to non-cooperation or civil disobedience, but he was not talking about violence. So that way there was nothing wrong in that. But this problem is that if aggression comes from the other side, and if the other side, the enemy, at that time the Congress, was brutal in all these matters, what should people do at such a large number? Should they surrender to them? So this was inherent in Mahatma's philosophy also. If we go to earlier stand, we will recall that Mahatma Gandhi also used to say that if I have to choose between bravery and cowardice, I won't choose cowardice. And here surrendering means it was something of act of cowardice. So I think this was one of the sentiment why many of the staunch Gandhians, they resorted to what could be seen as violent method. So there is nothing very wrong, and there is incongruous between the Quit India movement and the philosophy of Mahatma Gandhi. Whatever was done, that was provoked by the brutality of the British Indian government. Now, after such a long time, it is time to think about what is the significance of this movement for the post 42 era and before independence, and for the period after independence. The movement created, to begin with, this is very much significant that it created a very new situation, and the situation was underlined by the fact that the Quit India movement brought the question of India's independence at the top priority of the national agenda. This was the first thing it did. Without saying anything about that, but the happenings of the time, they compelled the whole situation to put the agenda of India's independence at the top, both for the Indian side and for the British side, because even if the Indians were brutally crushed during this movement, now they couldn't have any second thought, because it was either they had to gain it or to lose the battle. So this is very much natural that they decided to stand by and not to surrender to the British. On the British side, they realized something like the period of 1857, that it is not very easy to continue in India, and the situation was very much telling. And it was telling something which was not pleasant for the existence of the British Empire and the colonial rule in India. So they also started thinking in terms of transfer of power. Though this was crucial time, this is period of war, the war was had started in 1939 and it finally ended in 45. But in between this period, there were other situations also, which were in combination with the Quit India movement, which were compelling the British government to rethink and reconsider favorably in terms of India's freedom. All these developments were there. For example, there was a very ferocious famine in 1943. Likewise, the aggression of the world powers, of the Axis powers, it was coming closer to the British Empire, especially to India. Japan was very much knocking at the doors of India from the northeastern side, from Assam. Japan had captured Andaman Nicobar, some parts of Assam, etc. So it was danger. There was famine, there was danger of from the aggressive enemy, and the situation of the famine, it blew up the weaknesses of the colonial rule in India internationally. For example, in USA, this became an issue in favor of India's independence. In USA, already some political activities was going on in favor of Indian national struggle. Gadar Party was there since 1914, and around this time, around the time of the Second World War, there was a strong lobby advocating India's freedom there. And most of them, the NRIs, the Indians living in the USA, they were approaching the government to take up the cause of India's freedom. And that is why that at that time, Roosevelt government took interest in India's freedom. In from another angle also, just somehow the American intervention was by mistake invited by the British also. For example, during the Second World War, when India became a crucial center for any war in the east of the Suez, so the British Indian government invited the American government to advise and help to make how to make India a base for war in the east. This request led to the invitation of American delegation under Grady. Grady was an administrator. He came to India to advise on how to make use of India's resources for winning the war. But when he came to India, he studied the situation, and what he found was startling both for USA and for the whole world. It reported being a party, being a large power, a friend of the British Empire, it reported that India is so backward that its resources, if one has to use its resources, first is its people should be developed and provided the minimum material existence here. So this was a crucial situation, and it visualized that it was not possible to make Indian people minimally comfortable to live and exist. It is not possible unless and until they are granted freedom. So this was a peculiar situation compelling the British government. All these things gradually compelled the British Indian government to think in terms of independence of the country. Likewise, internally, riot was going on, though British were also responsible for the communal riots, and they knew about that. At times they were instigating also, but after all, it was a problem of civic administration, and the news of these disturbances was very much perturbing for the British image abroad. So these were different type of situation. In some areas, some disease also followed. In Bengal, after the famine, there were endemics and epidemics were there. So just political situation, the Quit India, the ferocious situation and experience of the time of the Quit India, the famine of 1943, pressure from the foreign country, especially from USA, one of the closest allies of the British government, and Japanese aggression from the east. These were situations which compelled the British Indian government to yield to the Indian demands after Quit India movement. And this is this type of development took some positive steps also. For example, after the failure of the movement and after the, all these factors that became very much compelling for the British government to address, the British government acted on two levels, mentally and psychologically. They thought of somewhere transferring the power, but still they had some greed and they wanted to retain India's empire. So to just to please the Indian opinion, they started a development, a reconstruction, post-war reconstruction program for the development of the country, and apparently they tried to do a lot, but all that remained only at the level of planning. So because they left the country in 1947, and until war they couldn't do much substantial anyway. So this was one achievement, greatest achievement of the Quit India movement, that it forced the government to think in terms of India's development. Likewise, it encouraged another forces which could pressurize the country, and that was promoting a situation for the INA of Subhash Chandra Bose to firm up and to enlarge its activities there. And lastly, it has provided for posterity a lot of experiences how a mob, even a most peaceful mob, can be violent if its grievances are not redressed in time. Thank you very much.
In a way, it was, we can say that it finally laid the last stone, yes, for the independence of the,
yes,
country. And but how do you see the previous commissions and others which came to India, their approach to tackle the demand of nationalists, and those who came later after Quit India, it was a change, forced change in their view, or you can say somebody says that it was evolutionary sort of thing, that they were also accepting the fact that now we can't hold India under British for more times. So what was
course,
the exact situation?
After the Quit India movement, mm-hmm, there was a radical departure in the way the British thought about the whole Indian problem. But of course, tactically, they won't like to express it to the public because it will be dangerous. It won't be diplomatically helpful for them. So they hid them all the developments at that time. So there was a definite change in the attitude of the British after Quit India movement, which was reflected when the cabinet mission came, and that came not to consider whether to leave India or not, rather it was to decide how to leave India. It means almost half it was decided that we have to leave India. Now the question is how to transfer power.
Mm-hmm. So Mahatma Gandhi was trying to have a discussion on equal terms since 1931.
Yes.
But after Quit India, it became really at equal term. Before that, it was not so. This helped, certainly this will help to have their point of view more aggressively, or more, we can say. But what was going that time in the British Parliament? Because somebody say that change in the formula of labor and other, they came, that's why we got the independence. Otherwise, if the previous party
that was one factor that Labour Party came and that became favourable for India's cause.
Mm-hmm.
But I have just now I have talked about other factors also.
Mm-hmm.
The British government was not able to control the Indian situation both internally and from outside, especially from, there was pressure from America.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a lot of bitterness between the British and the American government on the question of India.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, मतलब दिस वाज जस्ट वन फैक्टर व्हिच वी कैन सो फाइनली द कंट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ क्विट इंडिया मूवमेंट वाज पैरामाउंट यू कैन मैग्निमस व्हिच
या दैट वाज द लास्ट असॉल्ट एंड इन वे वेरी इफेक्टिव असॉल्ट इन वे या बिकॉज़ एसेंशियली इट वाज पीसफुल मूवमेंट ओरिजिनली इट वाज डिजाइंड टू बी अ पीसफुल बट इट बिकम वायलेंट दैट्स अनदर थिंग बट इट डिड हैव इट्स रिजल्ट्स इफ इट बिकम वायलेंट इट वाज नॉट बैड
ओके
यस
So, well, friends, with these words, we like to conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture. And on your behalf, I thank Dr. Jayan Sinha for giving such an insightful lecture on Quit India movement. This movement, as you came to know, very important for the getting the independence in 1947. Thank you very much.
Thank you.